wrote that the world doesn't need a savior. But every day I hear people crying for one.
We can save this world. With the right leadership.
There's a boy in that gay club that might lose his father. How could you get in the way when the only thing anybody is trying to do is give that poor child just a little bit of comfort? What happened to you, Sue? Please tell me what horrible, horrible thing happened to you that made you such a miserable tyrant.
Have a seat. Since I was a little girl, I've had exactly one hero. My big sister. You know how much I worshipped her? She was the sun and the moon to me. While I was still very young, I noticed that other people didn't feel the way I did. People were rude to her. They were cruel. They laughed at her. And so I began to pray. I prayed every night for her to get better. And nothing changed. So I prayed harder. And after a while, I realized I wasn't praying hard enough. It's that no one was listening. Asking someone to believe in a fantasy, however comforting, isn't a moral thing to do. It's cruel.
Don't you think that's just a little bit arrogant?
It's as arrogant as telling someone how to believe in God, and if they don't accept it, no matter how open-hearted or honest their dissent, they're going to hell? Well, that doesn't sound very Christian, does it?
Well, if that's what you believe, that's fine. But please keep it to yourself.
So long as you do the same. That kid could lose his father at any moment. You should start preparing him for that. I get the hell out of my office. I realize you're only half orangutan.
I like you and have no reason not to.
I like you and have no reason not to.
Hey, did you hear about that magic baby that was born in Bethlehem?
It is almost needless for me to point out some of these blaringly obvious hypocritical statements that are made in shows like Family Guy and other shows like Glee, some of the most popular shows on television today. And you see it over and over again, the promotion of evolution and other lies while they bash the one truth that God created the universe in 6 days, that God died for our sins. So marvel not when you see women dressed in clothes entitled sinful, with a cross in the background. And just like Bill Maher, who cherry picks the quote-unquote blown by the wind Christians that he interviews for his documentary to make us look foolish, CNN every week writes an article bashing the fundamentalist Christianity. And I don't mean fundamentalist Christianity as in thou must wear a skirt to go to heaven or thou must part thy hair this way to go to heaven. No, I'm talking about the fundamentalists that believe that Jesus Christ was God manifested in the flesh and died for our sins. Those that believe the Bible is the inerrant word of God.
Where are we?
This is Cohort, Brian. Same year, same time. But in this universe, Christianity never existed, which means the dark ages of scientific repression never occurred, and thus humanity is 1,000 years more advanced.
But I think it's important for the last one of us left alive to know this story. The story of the Griffin family history. Here's how it all began. Everything started with the Big Bang. It was a Saturday night, and God and his roommate Chugs were arm wrestling.
Ha ha ha! You're going down, man! Oh, dude, that is sick!
Yeah! Undefeated!
Oh, wait. Here comes another one. Quick, give me your lighter.
You smell that?
Then, over millions of years, evolution took its course. Of course, I'm obligated by the state of Kansas to present the church's alternative to the theory of evolution.
So you can see for yourself on CNN's belief blog, every Sunday they bash fundamentalist Christianity, the one true faith, and they promote every other faith like Mormonism, Islam, Buddhism, anything as long as it isn't the truth. They're trying to lead as many people astray as they can, just like movies like Rise of the Planet of the Apes. You say, how? I say it promotes evolution in a sci-fi kind of way. Just like Darwin being taught in our schools, and millions of people such as musicians, movie directors, writers, etc. have been influenced by not only Darwin but Friedrich Nietzsche. And I'm talking about people from Marilyn Manson to Adolf Hitler have been influenced by this man, and he declared God is dead. These are the people that are taught in our institutions. Actually be titled Monkey Bashes Christianity.
Dad, today at school, my teacher said we evolved from other animals. That's not true, is it?
Of course not, Stephen. We were created by Monkey God in his monkey image.
But how do we know for sure God's a monkey?
Well, do you think God throws his own poop and enjoys jumping up and down in place?
Yeah.
And do you think when he's eating bananas, he periodically stops chewing and looks around with an angry expression to make sure no one's plotting to steal them?
Yeah.
And do you think his ass is slightly less hairy than the rest of his body?
Yeah.
Then there's your answer, champ.
Okay, but how do we know God really loves us?
Because his son died for our sins. Monkey Jesus could have ripped off the Romans' arms and masturbated all over their bodies, but he chose love instead. And I think that makes him pretty darn special.
Cool. Thanks, Dad.
How's our son doing?
He's gonna be okay, Paula. He's gonna be...
Like I mentioned earlier, it is very needless for me to point out every single thing in these clips I'm showing you. But just as I saw as a child many bumper stickers, and as you can see right here, the message, evolve or die. Those in the last days shall be despisers of those that are good, and those that hold to the one true faith of Jesus Christ.
Oh shit, look at that one. They must have spent like 5,000 bucks on all those decorations. Hey Vishnu.
What?
Where are all the decorations for your birthday?
Ha ha, very funny.
No, seriously, where are they? Because I see like every house in America has decorations up for my birthday, but nothing for yours. Maybe they have some in India. Nope, nothing there. Just some guy wiping his ass with his hand. Ah, but seriously, dude, happy birthday.
2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 1 through 7. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. From such turn away, for of this sort are they which crept into houses and led captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
I finished the TV Guide crossword puzzle for the first time in my life!
It's a miracle!
Miracles indeed. And now, before we bring out our celebrity guest who'll praise me and my chauffeur Small Fee, it's time to gaze upon our holy shrine, the miracle that makes all our miracles happen, that preternatural portrait, that possessed peace dart, that painting from the promised land, Our Lady of the Weeping Souls.
Well, if it's an Elmo monster.
He knows Elmo's name.
Well, of course I do. Why, you've been on the top of my nice list. You've been a very good little monster this year, Elmo.
Our institutions try to replace our Lord with evolution and every kind of pagan idol in their pagan holidays they yet still celebrate to this day, and we as Christians cannot celebrate our faith. We can't even pray. We can't even say our Pledge of Allegiance, for it mentions the word God. This is a mockery and an atrocity. But there's much more atrocities than this going on in our country. For we can't even declare the word of God in public. And soon, I believe, I'm not saying it's prophecy, but I believe it will be outlawed to preach the word of God as it is. For it will be declared a hate crime. And you'll see here in this next clip, preachers ministering the word of God to those in sin and being arrested for the same thing. And the ones arresting them, well, you'll see what happens to them.
You're supposed to be able to freely speak your word in this country, even on street corners. If that's law, then why did two pastors get hauled off to jail? Tonight, the Ken's 5i team's Joe Conger investigates why the First Amendment didn't help them in a Bible bust.
Two men with a calling, and they call it out from a street corner.
It says, "Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord."
The asphalt serves as their church, and the curbs of downtown San Antonio provide the pulpit. For the Reverends Todd Leibovitz and Jeremy Hiltz, preaching is a labor of love. Saving souls is their goal. Everyone's soul.
Be set free tonight by the power of God.
And on this July 9th, the preaching pair begin their service in front of a club that caters to homosexuals.
I plead with you folks, by the mercy and grace of God, be saved, be reconciled to the Lord.
Leibovitz and Hiltz say this night's crowd is less than enthusiastic about hearing the word. It's a crowd that shouts back. And that includes San Antonio police, upset with the Bible thumping.
Shut up. I'm not putting away else, man.
I'm only going to give you one warning. This will be the only time.
Officers caught on video.
Be quiet.
I'm not leaving.
I am the one speaking.
I'm not leaving.
Be quiet.
Sir, you can just stop speaking. I'm not leaving.
I get one complaint, I'm telling you. It's only going to take one, and you're going to go to jail. You are the problem.
You tell me what law I make. They're the problem. They're the ones that are drunk. There's a lady coming out here drunk.
This ain't the problem, dude.
Once the camera's turned off, San Antonio police move in, arresting the preachers for harassment.
My client spent 16 hours in jail. They were actually in jail overnight with rapists, pedophiles, drunks, and everything else. For what? Preaching the good news of Christ.
When we got to jail, we pretty much just picked up where we left off here, just sharing the word with people and just helping to minister to the men that were in the jail.
Once out, the harassment charges were dismissed in county court. But mysteriously, the I team has learned another citation surfaced, this time in municipal court, where the preachers were charged with peddling without a license, peddling God's word.
I was out and just sharing the gospel, telling people that Jesus Christ will forgive anyone who will forsake their sins and trust in him.
Trouble is, peddling means you take money. The preachers did not, as they passed out tracts on Jesus Christ. And the city ordinance specifically makes exceptions for distributing religious publications, something the preacher's attorneys would bring up in court should they ever get the chance.
We're actually talking about speech itself in its most beautiful form, as people talking to other persons.
Leibovitz and Hiltz showed up for municipal court three different times in the last 4 months, different city prosecutors each time, and all met with the same thing, continuances. But it's a journey they accept as they follow their faith.
We weren't wrong. We have a First Amendment right to do what we were doing. Wherever we can find people, we'll share the gospel.
For the I-Team, Joe Conger, Kent's 5, Eyewitness News.
May not be the gospel, but it is good news. A new development to this story tonight. The city of San Antonio has dismissed the charges against the preachers.
Now we want to go back to the breaking news we're covering for you this morning. A San Antonio police officer behind bars right now, accused of sexually assaulting a man.
Christina De Leon is in the newsroom with the latest. Christina.
Well, good morning. I'm finding out the man he's accused of assaulting is actually transgender. He tells police he was picked up by Officer Craig Nash off Zeta Zamora and Guadalupe Street. This all happened yesterday morning, and the officer was arrested last night, according to the affidavit. This is a mugshot, our first look at Officer Craig Nash. We're learning the 39-year-old, according to this man, picked up the man at Guadalupe and Zarzamora, handcuffed him, told him to lay in the back seat, took him to a nearby location, then unhandcuffed him, and according to this man, performed two sex acts, then dropped him off at a school off Guadalupe Street. And that's when he got a bus to a police station. He walked into the police department and said, quote, he wasn't going to get away with this, and then told officers what indeed he says happened to him. Now, police, during their investigation, actually linked Nash's patrol car by GPS to the locations where this man said the sexual assaults took place. They also, on finding out, looked through patrol cars yesterday as part of their investigation yesterday early in the morning to find out if they could get some more evidence from those patrol cars. And also, this man who made the allegation ID'd Nash in a photo lineup, and he also had to go to a hospital to get a sane exam where more DNA evidence was collected, and I guess police felt like there was enough evidence to arrest Nash. Again, he was arrested two counts, one count of sexual assault and one count of official oppression, and his bonds have been set at more than $25,000, and this morning he is in the Bexar County Jail. That is the latest reporting live here in the newsroom. Christina De Leon.
And now we have another altercation caught on camera. This one is between Houston police officers and a group of street preachers. The preachers say they were manhandled by police and say their video will prove it. KHOU 11 reporter Rux Russell talked with both sides.
El Shaddai, the world that he gave has only begotten son.
It's often said the line between love and hate is thin. And between right and wrong, sometimes a bit blurred.
Did you see that? That was a middle finger.
And such is the case at Westheimer in Montrose.
This is our community. These are our people.
Where street preachers are spreading a word a lot of people might find offensive.
This is a very large gay community here, and I don't see this as anything but hurtful and disrespectful to those people.
And they're waiting for this word. They're waiting for someone to have the honesty and the forthrightness to tell them, no, it's not right.
That was also their message on Monday. At least until police showed up.
You got the first officer right here.
They captured the encounter on video.
Somebody called, I guess.
The first cop on scene said everything was okay.
I mean, y'all ain't doing nothing wrong.
No, sir.
But the officers who arrived minutes later.
Can't have these, all right?
Show me where.
Saw things differently.
I'm talking to you. Then what?
Hey, you can't legally break my camera,
hey,
sir.
Hey,
you can't legally break my camera.
Calm down.
Police cuffed and detained the men, then cited them for having an illegal instrument.
You got your homosexual one.
And displaying signs that are more than a quarter of an inch thick, which violates a city ordinance.
And this wood right here is 3/16 of an inch. So it's thinner than it's supposed to be. If they can take our signs from us, then we don't have a voice out here.
A police spokesperson says the men were initially combative with officers, refusing to give their IDs and failing to obey commands.
Yeah. It's a blessing.
It's a blessing.
But there's one command the men promise never to ignore. The one that draws them to a street corner.
On the mountain Zion.
With a controversial message. These men have been in the midst of turmoil before. Last year, they tussled with some folks out here at the gay pride parade. Now, they've got to be in court later this month, but in the meantime, plan to file a complaint with HPD Internal Affairs. A police spokesperson tells me if they do file that complaint, it'll be thoroughly investigated. I'm live in Montrose tonight. Rux Russell, KHOU.
Great wall of prophecy. Reveal to us God's will that we may blindly obey.
Free us from thought and responsibility.
We shall read things off you.
Then do them.
Your words guide us.
We're dumb.
Yes, truly, time is almost up. But thank God we have a blessed hope, and the rapture could happen at any moment. And nothing is stopping our Lord from coming back. No man can stay his hand. And if you take a look around at this world, it doesn't take you long to see that we are in the last days. For men are proud, boasters, arrogant, lovers of themselves, despisers of those that are good. Evolution and all the counterfeits of Satan are tattooed in our institutions. They are incorporated into every aspect of our lives, from childhood to adolescence. Theories such as evolution, which have no hypothesis, for they cannot be tested, and even its supporters would admit that it takes faith to believe in this theory. Therefore, it is a religion, and the followers of this faith have a circular method in which they verify their belief. They say the age of the fossils is verified by the plates they're found in, and vice versa. And it is not just in the institutions such as school that evolution is promoted. It's in every form of media, whether it be the news, comic books, as you see here, Spider-Man promoting evolution in Evolve or Die, as I've already forementioned in this film. That is what the true evolutionists believe. Either we will evolve into godhood, or you will pass into the next life. The New Age movement believes in a point in which all people on Earth will enter into what they believe is the next leap and bound in our evolution, and those that do not become God will die. Movies like Dragon Ball Z promote evolution. But of course, evolution isn't limited to one genre or one definitive audience. It is promoted in movies from the horror genre to action to kids' stories. Of course, they want to hit the kids the hardest. But you see here, not only in Dragon Ball Z, but the movie Underworld Evolution and the movie itself, Evolution, starring David Duchovny, which is about an alien coming to Earth and rapidly evolving. And you can also notice the third eye symbolism, the mind's eye symbolism here on the smiley face. The last movie I actually went to at the movie theater and was very disgusted by was X-Men First Class. What I had grew up on and thinking as a child was fictional and just superheroes that came and saved the day, I have later learned in my Christian walk with God that this is actually a twisting of the evolution story in a very subliminal way. They are promoting the same ideas that we can evolve to God. Here, look in the trailer for yourself.
Mutation. It is the key to our evolution. It has enabled us to evolve from a single-celled organism into the dominant species on the planet. This process is slow, normally taking thousands and thousands of years. But every few hundred millennia, evolution leaps forward.
Is out there. I feel their guns moving in the water, targeting us.
There are thousands of men on their ship. They're just following orders.
I've been at the mercy of men just following orders. Never again.
Isn't only a product that promotes evolution, as you can see here, biblical terminology like, quote, second coming. Maybe they are referring to the Antichrist. Countless comic books, movies, shows, and everything else that can be marketed promotes these biblical terms in some way, shape, or form. Which leads me to say, why did the heathen wish to show their heathenistic ways and all of their fruits of their labor? Even branding themselves with satanic logos like 666 and upside down crosses. Why, if you don't believe in something, would you brand yourself to prove how much you don't believe in it? I don't believe in Santa Claus, but do I tattoo upside down candy canes on me? Absolutely not. Even Stephen Hawking's predecessor Albert Einstein declared, matter itself cannot be willed into existence and must have a, quote, designer. Sadly, even some churches have adapted to the evolution theory and adopted with the gap theory and try to say that the 6 days in which God created everything were actually meant to be millions of years each day. Truly, everyone has a belief in God, and there is a perpetual calling heard around the world that is calling for unity. an ecumenical body to rule, as the Georgia Guidestones declare, a world religion. The United Nations, Theosophical Society, and millions involved in the New Age movement are the main promoters of this idea. You can see how many people have out nowadays the coexist bumper stickers on their car. This is a clear sign of a lost person. Here you see the cover of a 1960s magazine, Freemason magazine, entitled the quote New Age. We see them speaking to one another openly over 40 years ago. This isn't even the earliest of these types of promotions of world unity and a new age. Another code word for the new age of enlightenment is the word avatar, which means world teacher, or I suppose you could even define it as messiah. Here you see the new movie Avatar, which was a huge success. And here you have the Ascended Masters, or the Avatars of the New Age. Shows like Millennium promote New Age subliminal imagery even in its title. The snake seen here eating its tail, this is also noted as Satan's promise and lie to the world that those that follow him will be as God and he will rule this world forever. This is also in the logo of the Theosophical Society. This show promotes such New Age philosophies as telepathy, clairvoyancy, and contacting familiar spirits. The Theosophical Society is widely known as a supporter of the New Age movement. However, the Theosophical Society have, since the days of the founders, Helena Blavatsky and others, held to the same teachings that Freemasons like Albert Pike declared Luciferian. After Alice Bailey started promoting the Ascended Master's teachings through her channeled familiar spirits work, or as she calls them, Ascended Master's works, She started the publishing company Lucifer Publishing, which was later changed to Lucius Trust, which it is even unto this very day. This same printing company is the main disseminator of documents of the United Nations. With so many of these self-worshipping centers of dark enlightenment and so many media promotions from both New Age movement organizations and even magazines like Time Magazine or even so-called quote Christian magazines, it seems everywhere you turn, people are looking into themselves to find God through meditation and New Age philosophies. The show Out on a Limb even had a metaphor for Luciferian beliefs in its title, as the limb in the title was a metaphor for the tree of knowledge in the Garden of Eden. The show you're looking at is that very show. The show is about a woman who finds out that she is God through New Age teachings and the New Age movement. She gets in contact with spirit guides, finds a guru, and is enlightened with a dark enlightenment that I call the light of Lucifer. For even Lucifer comes as an angel of light.
Feel like you're not really being yourself?
Yes, all the time. Right.
That's what all the masters have tried to help us with.
What masters?
You know, Christ, Buddha, the Indian avatars. They were really just master politicians who went right to the root of the problems in society, the individual. Some of them said if everybody believed that he was a part of God, the kingdom of heaven was within. And that if we took responsibility for that, that we wouldn't get so frustrated with ourselves. With ourselves or with anybody else. But it seems like it takes multiple lifetimes to come to that simple realization.
Why isn't reincarnation in the Bible? Why isn't it taught in Christianity?
Ah, well, that brings us to the controversial Second Council of Constantinople in 553 AD, which was so dominated by the Emperor Justinian that the Pope, in protest, refused to attend. So, Justinian got his way. And in spite of the fact that reincarnation could be found in many of the writings of the early church fathers, his council condemned the idea of the pre-existence of the soul.
Emperor Justinian, what do you want to do a thing like that for?
Well, I guess once you get used to the idea of being an emperor, you don't want to have to believe that someday you might have to come back as a pig slopper.
Yeah, but why did the church go along with it?
Well, I think at first Justinian pressured him into it, but then later I think they went along with it because they just didn't want people to assume their responsibility for their own karmic destiny.
Karmic destiny. Well, you know, if I really believed that I lived before and was going to live again, and that everything I put out there would come back, there would be no doubt in my mind that I'd be completely responsible for everything that happens in my life.
Exactly.
That's mind-boggling, David. I mean, when you think of what that really means.
You want to know a good exercise that helps you get in touch with the realization that we each have God inside of us?
Exercise.
Here's what you do. Just stand up, hold your arms out like this, and say, the kingdom of heaven is within. I love myself.
The kingdom of heaven is within. I love myself.
No way, better than that. Say, I and God are one. No, wait, better than that. I got the best one. This is the best one. Just say, I am God.
David, I can't say that.
See how little you think of yourself? You can't even say the words?
I am God. I am God.
A little louder, please, with maybe a little more conviction.
I am God. I am... Look, if I'm God, what does that make you?
Well, we always see in others what we see in ourselves. I am God. I am God.
I am God.
I am God.
I am God. God. I am God.
I am God.
I am God.
I am God.
I am God.
I am God. I am God.
I am God.
In the inmate.
Of course. I'll have him in shape in no time.
If they live through it.
Harriet!
Yeah?
Keep him moving.
Okay.
And if you live through it, you'll love her as much as I do.
Let's get going.
I think I'll walk with you for a while.
Great.
So, I hear through the grapevine you're finding yourself drawn to spirit. Is that true?
Yeah, I guess you could say that. I'm into a whole new dimension of myself anyway.
Oh, isn't it wonderful, Shirley?
Is it? Are you doing the same thing?
Of course. What else is there? Yeah, I've been guru hopping most of my life, Sai Baba and all that. Now I know it's me who has all the answers.
Now, I know I should plunge on ahead, but I don't know quite how to go about it, you know?
Are you interested in meeting someone adventurous?
A man?
Kind of.
What do you mean, kind of?
He used to be a man.
What's he now, a showgirl in San Francisco?
No. He isn't incarnate right now.
Isn't incarnate? You mean a spiritual entity, Kat?
Yeah, that's what I mean. They're the only people worth talking to these days.
Kat, come on.
Seriously, there's this magnificent spiritual entity you must meet. His name is Ambres, and he channels through a man named Johansson.
Trans-channeling? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, that's what I mean. Johansson is a simple carpenter who lives in Stockholm, and his teacher Ambres uses Johansson as an instrument to speak through.
Really?
Oh, surely his teachings are magnificent. I was in Sweden last year. You really should treat yourself.
Stockholm, huh?
Don't you need to buy a pair of skis or something? Wouldn't you like to see Brigitte again? She knows Ambres and she could translate for you.
No, I need a mountaintop I can sit on. Jerry, I miss you.
Yes, I miss you too. Can you meet me in Stockholm next week?
Stockholm? Stockholm, Sweden?
Oh, God.
The synchronicity.
What?
Nothing.
I know it's cold, Dana, but I'm going to be there for about 2 weeks. I have something important I want us to talk about.
I cannot believe this. Should I get my own hotel?
If you wouldn't mind. I'm staying at the Grand. Now, if you phone me on Monday morning, use the name Edwards, and leave a message with the number of your hotel.
Okay. Jerry, I love you. I love you, and I want...
Jerry was so romantic whenever he said goodbye. And then it hit me. What did he want to say to me?
My advice to you, brothers and sisters in Christ, as this message is for you, this entirety of this film was for you, for edification, and for strengthening in your spirit. And I pray that it does strengthen your spirit, and I pray God will touch many hearts with this. And my advice to you is to be wary of the self-titled truth movements that are so many spread abroad in this day and age. With so many people jobless, it seems that so many people are look into the conspiracy and looking to see what's going on in the world, and they're informing themselves with knowledge. They aren't always coming to the knowledge of the truth. Now, I don't want you to get in yoke with these types of people. So test the spirits see what kind of spirits these people have. The groups like Anonymous hacking the government websites, they know that in turn there's just going to be stricter laws enforced on the internet. They know that what they're really doing is working with the government. The words of our Lord and the words of the Bible seem to just jump off the page when you see what days we're living in these latter times.
You know, Christian advocates and publishers out there are really upset because there's a new series that has a pilot that is based on a book called Good Christian Bitches. And there's just been a pilot. The network hasn't even picked it up yet. And they're up in arms. I mean, really? Are those where our priorities lie?
Unfortunately, for a lot of people, the answer to that question is yes. I mean, the fact that a Twitter feed got turned into a TV show and they still had to bleep the title, I think, says a lot about what passes on networks these days. And unfortunately, people would rather complain about the title of a TV show because that distracts us all from noticing that there are a lot of people out there trying to take women's rights away.
Well, you know, I think this is something that a lot of people are debating, too. When it comes to the word bitch, is it still bad? Is it always derogatory, or has it become a little mainstream? You know, I love that Jezebel was using the example of Britney Spears and some of her pop music to show that some people use it, you know, as a form of empowerment.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, Elizabeth Wurtzel's book, Bitch, was a great example of young feminists trying to reclaim the word bitch as something that's positive.
It isn't the fact that they use this derogatory term that is used to insult women in their title, but it is that they try to tie it with Christ and Christians, and it is that it portray Christians as such demoralized, hypocritical, self-indulged people. This is why Christians are up in arms about this show, and not what this lady says.
Karen, I can't believe you even remember me.
How could we forget you?
Oh, Cricket. Wow. Heather, hi! Yeah. I saw your photo on like 40 bus stop benches as I drove into town.
Oh, it's nice to know that someone somewhere is always sitting on my face.
Heather, how's it going? Zach!
Wow!
Oh my God. It's great to see you.
Sharon, doesn't Amanda look amazing? I mean, I think you look even better than you did in high school.
Sharon, you're still married. That's so wonderful.
Hey, I really liked your Sunday school lesson today. All that talk about David and Bathsheba, lust in your heart stuff kind of got me in the mood.
The Bible lesson was about the downfall of lust. Didn't you learn anything? Speaking of lust, look at the men. They're all over her like flies on sugar.
So that's Amanda, huh?
Stop staring.
I can't believe the hostility. Was I that bad back then?
Oh, darling, you were a bitch with teeth.
Okay, I get it. Got it. But I've changed. I've grown up. I've had kids. I've had some knocks. Nobody can stay exactly like they were in high school.
Don't you think we can learn from it?
Oh, yes, they can.